Greetings. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Wanted to thank you for subscribing and liking and also the comments placed on our site. Today's talk focuses on the 2170 and 18650 batteries, a few of the differences, as well as the competitive threat that's been articulated by some large competitors. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Bonjour, wie geht's? Wie steht's noch im Ausfall bei den Straßen? Ni hao ma, maslamcha, maslamek, and buongiorno. This is Greg, and I wanted to review today sort of some new developments that I noticed that popped up regarding the 18650 and the 2170 battery. The first component of this is that Samsung announced, I guess, 2 or 3 months ago that now that Tesla's introduced the 2170, they haven't seen the battery yet, but by 2021, they will have at-scale responses to that battery. I was a little surprised by the Panasonic response for several reasons. Number one is that upon the announcement that Tesla was coming out with this battery, you know, Samsung is one of the world's leading manufacturers and almost one of the inventors of this whole space. So to have them chasing after Tesla in order to provide solutions to their automobile clients around the world was a big surprise, because one would think they would be the ones driving the envelope of performance. As you probably all know, one of the issues that's going on with this battery is the fact that Samsung, et cetera, had chosen what's called a pouch technique, in which you put the lithium-ion batteries in a pouch, and the pouch goes in a frame, and that structure of implementation gave out low cost. But the problem was that the structure also did not lend itself well to supercharging. So this is actually the reason why things like the Nissan Leaf, even the Chevy Volt or Bolt, and some of the other, you know, BMW and other solutions are incapable of doing supercharging, because that pouch is a low-cost way to get the job done, but it doesn't lend itself to good heat management when it comes to things like supercharging. And in fact, there's a gas that's produced by that process with a pouch that potentially causes explosions. So I was sort of intrigued to see, a powerful competitor like Samsung is basically explaining that they're chasing Tesla in this space to figure out how the future is going to look in electric. Now, another facet to this is the fact that everyone's been chasing the 18650 battery that Tesla was delivering, and now that they have to start chasing the 2170, this also introduces another problem, which is not only do you have to be capable of producing one solution, you may have to be able to produce two solutions in order to be competitive with Tesla. So I really think this kind of doubles up on the competitive challenges that other manufacturers are facing. Another sort of dialogue point on this sort of gap is that Tesla has announced that they're not bringing the 2170 to the Model S and Model X. I was kind of surprised by this, and I read one Tesla owner who was eagerly waiting for this solution, because you'd end up with a car that could go 500 or 600 miles based on the properties available on the 2170. What I'm thinking is that based on the 2170 being a brand new battery, et cetera, one of the big challenges all the electric batteries are having is how do you deal with heat? And the bottom line is that, you have a bigger battery. I think that supercharging is going to be heat deal with enough for this. And basically Tesla's saying that they'd rather not have to deal with the supercharger of this battery when it's brand new and untested. And that's an error on my part. It's not even a supercharger issue. It's a ludicrous issue, because it's one thing to power electrons into the battery quickly. It's another thing to demand a very rapid expulsion of those electrons as they're being used in a ludicrous or very high performance setting. The 2170 is said to be optimized for trucking as well as for low costs. I mean, trucking may not be a sort of a high speed expulsion, but you are using a lot of torque when you climb those mountains. And I wonder if the battery demands going up a giant mountain might not be the equivalent of ludicrous mode. We'll find out what that looks like as Tesla does its announcements on trucks. But nonetheless, you know, that's the situation. I think this creates nightmares for a lot of manufacturers because they now have to pick their poison, either 18650 design that Tesla's had on the streets for quite a while, or the 2170 design, sort of introduces more bogeys for them to shoot at. And they haven't caught up with 5 years ago, so I just think this is really an interesting circumstance. The last thing I wanted to cover in this round is sort of what I want to call, you know, the 2170 is showing up in the Model 3 aggressively. And I'm fascinated by what I call the knots on the Model 3. So you will not get supercharger on the Model 3. I'm sorry, you will get supercharger. You will not get ludicrous mode on the Model 3. So there's really an effort there to make sure the performance doesn't rival or exceed the Model S, because with the lower weight, you know, this definitely could occur. Another knot is that you won't be getting things like a speedometer / odometer, et cetera, because that's all on the main screen. And we've actually covered this in an earlier video regarding the fact that that data is now powered to mobile devices, so you can sort of replicate some of those engine parameters on your own to be placed on your dash if that's something that is of interest. I actually think that the lack of performance by the 2170 that's being dropped into the Model 3 might actually be in the best interest of owners. And the reason I say this is that it turns out that both supercharging and ludicrous mode are either rapid put in or rapid take out of electrons from the battery. And the less you do these rapid charge and discharges, I want to say the more longevity and happier your battery might be. I'm told that there are 1,200 cycles charge and discharge that are available in these batteries. I don't know if that's the exact number, but it's one of the data points that I read. It also turns out that each of those batteries has cells within them. And so not all of those cells are charged up on each charge, so that 1,200 cycles may be a little bit low based on the fact that if you're not using highest level performance, you're able to sort of manage the life of the cells within your battery a little better. The final note I wanted to make here is that I'm really fascinated by the dearth of how to take care of your cells that's going on. At this point, because Tesla's battery's only been out there for about 5 years, the data that's out is on the percentage of degradation that you have at about 200,000 miles is somewhere around 10%. But they didn't say if those sort of tested cells had an opportunity to be reviewed for heavy use of superchargers or ludicrous mode. What I'm getting at is the fact that I think, you know, vehicles that end up back on the market, be it 3s, X's, or S's, are going to be graded according to how hard the users were using them, either superchargers or ludicrous mode, and helping customers to get a grasp of best practices for managing their vehicles, I think would be a smart move and really healthy short and long term for these vehicles. So I think there's some sort of interesting battery points here. Looking forward to, the biggest look forward for me is it's only mid-July right now. The huge question that's sitting in the back of my mind, and perhaps a lot of people's minds, based on the trucking interest I've seen, is the 2170s, let's say, 30 to 50% reduction in weight enough to allow the trucks to go 500 miles? And if it is, that's a significant turn of events. And so we're all eager for the answer to that. I think the answer is yes. I want to thank you for taking time out to view us once again. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Tschüss, mach's gut, au revoir, tout à l'heure, la hitra hot, choda hafez. Have a great day. Please like and subscribe. Thank you.